All right, Kathy, well, the time is finally here. You're going to walk me through my first Gow-Gates. And let me say, before we get started, that Dr. Murison, who graduated from dental school this year and had tuition costs, I'm just going to guess, of over $250,000, $250,000, and didn't learn the Gow-Gates. And as a dentist, you know, here you are at Pierce College teaching the hygiene students how to do it, and you and I, as dental students, didn't get to learn how to do it. So I'm going to make a demand to the ADA that they step in and do this. But anyway, neither of us, I thought maybe just because I'm old, I didn't learn it, but she graduated this year, still didn't learn it, so that's fine. So she wanted to experience one, and this will be good for both of us. So how do we get started? What should we do first?
Well, first off is just, you know, switch our thinking from the parallel to occlusal table that we think of for the IA to finding what's going to be your upward inclination. So the area we're looking at is from the corner of her mouth to her inner tracheal notch.
Okay.
And, you know, just hold the mirror up there and then just kind of imprint that angle there.
And this is different on everybody? Are there people where it's
it's
markedly different?
You know, I think they're generally, you know, it has, you know, a subtle inclination, but this will be specific to her because we're trying to orient to where her condyle is.
And this is done with her mouth closed, not open?
To start with, yeah. Okay. So just start there till you get that, and then you have to have her go ahead and open wide and see how much it changes. See, it doesn't change much because you're still going to her commissure.
Okay.
So one of the things I find really helpful is when I'm palpating, is I'll actually put my finger right there, the inner tracheal notch, and then as I pull back, then I'm kind of lining my finger up and giving myself, you know, that orientation.
Oh yeah, yeah, yeah. You're actually kind of seeing that for yourself now with the angulation of your finger.
Yeah, because otherwise, you know, I'm used to lining up this, so my brain's going to take me here for my standard IA. But I want my brain to go with me up here.
No, I used to actually seem to recall that people actually put their finger in the patient's ear to do it. Is that not really necessary? Or? I mean, I
can appreciate that, you know, that might help them, you know, have a sense of where the condyle is. Same way if you're doing a TMJ check.
But you can't push the you're not pushing the condyle forward at all with your
finger.
No,
and even my finger and half, she opens wide, you know, you can feel the articulation, so you're going to feel it move. So, I, you know, I know it's about here. Yeah, then my next sort of, you know, imaginary thing is then when I turn her back around, okay, I know where my finger is, and it's going to be a mental image as if I am aiming for my finger. Because my finger now is right next to the condyle.
Okay.
So here, you know, over here where I'm moving my finger, you know, that's my target height.
Right.
So where my penetration, I just, you know, let my brain
try to. Yeah, it's kind of like
Walk on.
Yeah, it's kind of like just having a finger here, and then you're going to start over here, and you can't see it, so you'd have to turn your head and then try to bring your two fingers together. And
exactly.
It's like a roadside sobriety test.
Yeah. The other So when I come in, I want to choose the height of my penetration in respect to the mesiolingual cusp of the molar.
Okay.
And I'm going to be distal to the second molar.
Okay.
Still, I'm coming in over the bicuspids.
Okay.
Penetration will be there. Open as wide as you can for me. Slightly uphill inclination. And again, as if I'm able to track towards my finger palpating on her condyle.
Any idea why you would use the mesiolingual of the first molar versus the second molar since you're back behind the second molar? Is it...
Has to do with how the height of the condyle.
Okay.
Because if I'm using a tooth up higher, I'm going to be, you know, higher. If I'm using the tooth down lower.
Okay.
So that gives me a line with the height of the condyle.
Okay, sounds good.
And I'm coming out over here. The one other thing that sometimes we can use to our advantage is if you look at the flare of her tragus right here. And hers is fairly smooth. It just flares out just a little bit. But if someone has, you know, quite a bit of flare out, that can have to do with how far out their ramus flares. So if they have a very narrow chin, then the tragus may be tucked in if they have a fair amount of flare. So that's going to help me decide how far over in relationship to the bicuspids I'm going to be. They're going to be, you know, really wide flare, then I might be back closer to the molar.
Okay.
If they're much narrower profile, then I may be a little bit closer to the
cuspid. Because the wider the jaw is, the condyle is going to be positioned farther laterally and therefore more, flare because of that. And so you would swing around more towards the molars. Okay.
So we get that, again, you know, aiming.
And there's probably room to swing over to the molars because of the fact that the mandible is a little wider versus somebody who's got a very narrow one.
Mm-hmm.
All right. Okay. Sounds good. Well, I guess I get to do a dry run with the topical anesthetic, right? So I'm going to start from over the bicuspids on the opposite side and go to the height of the mesiolingual cusp of the first molar, and then move distal to the second molar and place the topical there. How does that look to you, Kathy, for an
that looks good
injection point?
Good.
You know, and that's a good example how it's not a steep angle up, you know, given how far she can open.
Yeah, and I'm looking at that angle, and you know, it looks hers. Pretty close to the angle of my finger, like mm-hmm. you mentioned before. So.
And it's subtle. It's not drastic compared
right.
to here.
It's not pointed at you know, magnetic north. Okay, so as you mentioned, it doesn't, since we're going to be doing the twizzle that you referred to, and we're going to keep everything nice and straight, it really doesn't matter. It really doesn't matter where we put the bevel, in essence. In fact, we're not exactly sure where the bevel might end up anyway, but it almost doesn't matter because we're going to have it just tracking straight because of the twizzling that we're doing.
And that's going to be, you know, with all the things that we do with the wand, it's we're doing birotational and...
Right. So by rotation, I'm going to grab it a little farther back because it's for a block and not for an infiltration. Okay,
get some distance.
Okay, how you doing? Right there.
Right here?
Yep, you're okay. Good right there. If you can you see that okay?
Yeah.
Okay.
A little pinch here, Anna Maria.
And then just go ahead and start your twizzle whenever you're ready. And just keep your focus on, you know, where that location is near the condyle.
So typically on a Gow-Gates like this, how much of the carpal cath will you take getting back there to your target site?
You know, you've got about 8 seconds before this is going to automatically start into cruise. And I find that that's adequate to get there. And my guess is I'm anticipating you're going to have contact here shortly.
Right there, I do.
Okay. See, and that's about 3/4.
Mm-hmm.
You know, it's traditional for an IA.
And aspirated at this point, yeah.
Correct.
And
from here, things that are
it's
similar.
It's positive there, so you want me to come okay. back out and...
Let's do.
Okay. How far? Right about here, maybe?
Do you feel you can clear that?
Yeah, what direction would you like me to clear it in?
Just go ahead and do a second aspiration and see if we've got anything.
Well, I'm going to have to...
Okay, that looks clear.
Let's okay.
Go ahead and go back to site.
With
yeah, go ahead and just twizzle. Yeah, go ahead and advance again. And then aspirate again at your site. And if we're clear on that one, we'll continue.
Yeah, we
that
are.
That looks good.
Okay.
And that's one of the nice things, you know, from this view, you can't see it, but you're clear right from the attachment through the entire thing. So if you have, you know, any positive aspiration, it's really easy to pick up on the wand.
Well, I'm really happy I got a positive aspiration on my first one.
Fun.
A, with you here, and B, you know, just to see how to... You know, just a little nice refresher on how to handle it well while you're there. And so typically then for a Gow-Gates, once we're in here and expressing it at the normal speed, will you do a full the rest of the carpal
we'll
here?
We do a full cartridge.
Okay. Mm-hmm. And then that's it? Just that one cartridge and then stay open for 2 minutes?
And like the conversation we had this morning, you know, because that the soft tissue space in there will accommodate more. Many people will just choose to do 2 cartridges, mm-hmm. which is super because we would just do our switch out. You'd hold your position, we'd reload at the base of the STA unit, and then go ahead and deliver the second
okay.
cartridge.
At this point, with me back all the way, would you ever take your thumb and put it on the occlusal table to kind of remind the patient to open a little bit at this point?
You sure can.
But
you sure can.
I feel like if I'm in contact, like I am now,
mm-hmm.
that, you know, with her, that she must be open enough if I'm contacting the bone. Is that correct to think that way or not necessarily? Because I feel like I'm against that part of the, you know,
as long as it's not changing your needle depth, if she started to close
oh,
and
okay,
she started to see
it,
the needle sink
okay.
away from you, then you'd really tell that the condyle
okay.
is pulling away. But that's not a bad technique to just gently remind them.
You know, I also have to say that this is literally the first time I've ever used a 25 gauge. We were taught all 27 gauges in school, and so that's what I always used. I really like how it felt, and I really like what the contact felt like. We talked about in the interview that little that little kiss, and that's kind of what it felt like. Whereas with a 30 gauge, I could see how it might not feel so definite. Like, it just feels like I have a definite tactile feel because of the larger gauge.
Yeah, in our experiences, patients really aren't able to tell the difference between the needle gauges. And if it's just psychological for us,
right,
and being able to maintain some control in those denser tissues, you know, there's some reasonable logic to that.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, I've seen those studies too where they can't tell the difference between a 25 and a 27. So why would we do it for us if we can give more effective ones? All the patient cares about is being properly anesthetized, you know, so.
It's our own psychology.
Do you ever speed up at all on these injections, or are you very patient with these? Or maybe if you saw a patient starting to close and having trouble staying with them?
I tend to stay with the normal rate on these. I know that there's a turbo, but it's like, you know, if you think about injection hydraulics, and the smaller the gauge of the needle, the higher the pressure will be at the needle tip. The faster you expel, the greater the pressure. So if you just think about your garden hose, you know, putting your finger over it and creating a spray when you're washing your car.
Right.
We speed up, we use smaller gauges, and we're putting out a lot of pressure right at that needle tip. And the whole mechanism of paresthesia, they don't know.
Right.
It's a combination of things, and certainly the injection hydraulics has been discussed and looked at and can be part of that whole mechanism. So I think if we can control any of those factors, why wouldn't we?
Right. All right, there we go. That Jamaican drum tells you that we're done. Guess that you don't need to buy rotational on the way out, but it was fun to do.
It was fun to practice it again.
Wow, now if you would, I remember from you telling me this morning that we want the patient open for 2 minutes, so Anna Maria, I'm going to make it easy for you. There you go, just relax against that. Oh, perfect. And I will start the clock for 2 minutes, and we'll see if we have any anesthesia by the time that 2 minutes comes around. But all right, it's been 2 minutes. I'm going to go ahead and remove that. You can go ahead and close, Anna Maria. Actually, it's been a little more than 2 minutes. Whoa. Let me ask you, and I want you to be perfectly honest, unless it's an answer I don't want to hear. Are you starting to get...
upper and lower.
Upper and lower. Mm-hmm. Kathy, what does that mean? Was I in the wrong spot?
If she's upper, remember that the maxillary branch of the trigeminal nerve is going anterior about the same point that the mandibular branch is dropping down. So when we're up that height, we can definitely get collateral anesthesia. People will often have their auriculotemporal nerve also anesthetized. So not at all uncommon to have the ear feel some numbness too.
All right. Thank you. That was awesome. Thank you.